mother, Selma, Elizabeth, Atkins, come to worship the Lord this morning. We come to worship the Lord because she has placed her faith in Christ, and she knew that once this life was over, that wasn't the end. Amen?
Amen.
But to be absent from this body is to be present with the Lord. So we've come to worship the Lord, and we come to give thanks and celebrate, and we've come to cry, we've come to laugh, we've come to just enjoy this moment where the Lord has allowed life to bring us to. Now, I've been instructed that we must be on the road by 11:30. No, they're not leaving here at 11:30. But the four wheels, the four-wheel drive, the all-wheel drive, the two-wheel drive, front wheel, back wheel, have to be rolling by 11:30. Amen?
Amen.
So will you help me make sure? Amen?
Amen.
And even if I get the wraps, you know, just clear your throat. You know, something like that to remind me as well. We're going to ask at this time that we have our prayer comfort. Reverend Dr. Joseph L. Ross is coming. Following that, we're going to have our Old Testament and New Testament scriptures read. Sheila Campbell and Deborah Williams will come at that time. And then we will have a selection, the prayer, with Gary and Maureen Bostick will come in that order. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning. Good morning.
Take the person's hand next to you and say, I'm glad you're here.
Glad you're here.
Anyone here been to Israel? Are you familiar with the Church of the Beatitudes? Beautiful place, rolling green hills, beautiful churches there. And so, I would like to take you to the first public message in Scripture that Jesus spoke, rather than creating a prayer, if you don't mind.
Amen.
It's in the fifth chapter of Matthew. It's called the Beatitudes. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the poor in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And in closing, the scripture says, you are the salt of the earth. And truly, Selma exemplified that with her life. Amen. May the Lord bless you some more.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
I'd like to offer my sincerest condolences to Dorothy, Jackie, and the family, and I pray that the reading of the word will bless and comfort you. I'm reading from Isaiah 61, verses 1 through 3, and then verse 10 and 11. It says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn, to appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, to give unto them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they might be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he might be glorified. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord, my soul shall be joyful in my God. For he hath clothed me with garments of salvation, he hath covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decketh himself with ornaments, and as a bride adorneth herself with her jewels. For as the earth bringeth forth her bud, as the garden causeth the things that are sown in it to spring forth, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring forth before all the nations. But you must not forget, dear friends.
I knew her briefly, but I knew her to be a woman of God. And the other thing I knew about her is she had a prayer.
Yes.
And so we felt especially pleased that she selected the prayer for us to sing. Because that's what she, I mean, she was a godly, God-centered woman. And so I'm hoping that you can enjoy in your memories how wonderful she was in your lives. She's touched all the lives of people.
I agree with all that. A wonderful warrior full of Lord. She's such a joy to be around, full of life, full of spirit, full of laughter. I enjoyed her to the utmost. And she extended that to her fruits.
Amen.
You see her work going on. So be encouraged. God bless. We'll be praying.
Reaching out.
of every child.
Charms of life, every child needs to find a place. Guide us with your grace. Give us faith so we'll be saved.
Precious friends in the form of her neighbors, many as you've heard already over 50 years. That would age me, but don't count that. So don't be mad. But I do want, if there are any Lawnside neighbors here, could you guys just stand for a second? Oh, look, now see. Just flowers, fountain grass bursting, edges. But as she got a little overwhelmed and a little sick, I would still come around and make that left and that diagonal. It would still be that diagonal. Y'all know what I'm talking about with the grass? I'm like, how is this happening?
When we first moved to Lawnside, my mother found herself in an unfortunate situation as a single parent in the 60s. You couldn't even get a mortgage in your name, in a woman's name in the 60s. Wow. And she was walking. And she had two little kids. And a neighbor said, "I noticed you walking. Are you headed into Philadelphia?" She said, "Yes." Those neighbors drove her into Philadelphia for many, many years until she was able to get a little wagon, a Hornet, I think that car was called. No air, no radio. She was able to keep a job because the neighbors. And I just want to say to the Lawnside neighbors, you know, we in a virtual age where you put a funeral notice on somehow like it. What is that, right? You have friends, you have virtual friends. You don't even have real friends, they're all virtual. And I want y'all to look at the people who I asked to stand.
Amen.
They said, this is what they told me. We noticed, and everybody I talked to, my mom said, yeah, we noticed. She wasn't out there on that
lawn. Y'all can say on that lawn.
It was almost a quote. I'm like, did y'all go to mom's school? We noticed she wasn't out there on that lawn. But the lawn, she was in the hospital, but the lawn wasn't in the hospital. I want everybody to know we in a virtual age. I'm an IT director. I like technology. But a virtual neighbor, right, is not a real neighbor. Overwhelmed with care and different things, and they just stepped. I never asked them one time to do that. It never came out my mouth. They just took care of it. Hallelujah. And as the neighbors have had their different challenges in life, they, and Miss Burton would tell, and my mother even took strength in one of her neighbors as she cared for her daughter. And they would talk shop about that. Then she would talk shop about the lawn. And they would, the snow, it was snowing as the neighbors were getting older. They would band together and go and shovel one driveway out and then come over and shovel the other driveway out. That's a, not a virtual neighbor. That's a real neighbor. And God helps us through people. You praying and praying. Lord, help me. He's sending you a neighbor. Value them. Treasure them. Be with them when they're going. More neighbors, Lawnside neighbors are coming in. The Lawnside neighbors kept her going when she couldn't do it. The kids would come over and everything was. So I just want to take time to thank the many Lawnside neighbors for the decades of not virtual, but real, in your face, hard times. Help somebody. Neighbors, and she loved y'all. Y'all were her best. Who has friends for 50 years? Y'all were her best friends. And the Burtons and everybody, I don't want to call names, but and the Tollivers, everybody who's here from Lawnside, on her behalf, I just want to thank you for being her friend.
Amen. Of Selma's. We taught together at Hamilton School for a number of years, and I remember on the first day I saw Selma. She helped me out, we became good friends, and I even worked in a program that she initiated, the Hamilton Elementary Academically Talented Program. Selma started that. And she thought I would be a good candidate, a good teacher in that program. And we worked together in that program for a number of years. She was an excellent teacher, always professional, just a wonderful lady and a good friend.
Amen.
Obituary. If she were to tell it, Selma Elizabeth was born to the best parents God ever created, John and Grace Smith, in Philadelphia, PA on August 9, 1937. She loved her parents and spoke of their sacrificial care and wisdom every day. Even on the day of her death, June 27, 2019, she softly mentioned how she was so ready to see them and her grandmother and Jesus. In true Philadelphia style, she's showing us what an Independence in Jesus Day celebration is really all about. Selma loved learning and excelled in school. In 1955, she graduated from the prestigious Philadelphia High School for Girls and went on to earn her master's plus 30 in education from Temple University, where she was on the dean's list. In 1993, she retired from a distinguished career as a dedicated Philadelphia public school teacher. During that time, Selma also established the first literacy program at the Deliverance Bible Institute in North Philadelphia to serve the learning needs of adults looking to better themselves through education and spiritual enrichment. Watching her adult students turn their lives around was a great source of pride to which she was singularly devoted. Selma was also a gifted musician, playing piano and organ for churches, choirs, and groups, and even briefly fronted a jazz trio, the Bird Trio, in the 1950s. After retirement, she borrowed a portable keyboard from her daughter and faithfully brought the word and musical program to the Voorhees Center Nursing Home as a missionary with the Bethany Baptist Church. Selma's artful flair and love for the beauty of nature was always expertly demonstrated by her lawnside gardens at Carver Court, her calligraphy works of art that she briefly started a business for, and her dollhouse masterpieces that she pored over in great detail to delight her grandchildren. Most importantly, though, Selma loved her family, biological and adopted. Every holiday and birthday was a time to decorate and cook and gather everyone around for laughing and eating and singing and praying and love. By this, they will know you are my disciples if you love one another. John 13:35. Selma is now singing with her two sisters, Jean and Rita, her mother and father, and granddaughter Grace, who preceded her in death. She is survived by her brother John Jr., her two daughters, Dorothy and Jacqueline, her beloved grandchildren, Lauren, Jordan, and Lindsay Nathaniel, her precious great-grandbaby, Olivia, her bonus son, David, her extended family, and a host of dear friends, students, associates, and co-laborers in the ministry. Many daughters have done virtuously, but thou excellest them all. Favor is deceitful, and beauty is vain. But a woman that feareth the Lord, she shall be praised.
My sister, Sister Atkins, who became my spiritual mother. I met Sister Atkins in 1980. I had just decided that I wasn't going to do drugs no more, womanizing. I wasn't going to shoot people no more. I decided I want to give my life to the Lord. I had enough. I couldn't take it no more. So the first thing I read was the book of Revelations, where it says that whosoever readeth this book and apply this word to his life, God will bless you. And if you don't, He would put the curses upon you that he put upon all those that were in Egypt. I started reading that, and before I know it, I start quenching, and I didn't know what it was. So my brother Richard, who I came in with, he said, I got somebody you need to talk to. I went to Sister Atkinson, and I talked to her and told her how I felt and everything. And she took, and she led me down a road that I've been going down for 40 some years now.
Amen.
And
amen.
My name is Reverend Andrew Tolliver, or Minister Andrew Tolliver. Okay? And I want to talk about faith, because faith by Sister Atkinson is why everyone is in here today. Okay? The Lord said he's going to give us a crown for the works that we do here down on this earth. But we are the jewels that's in her crown. Because she reached out and touched my life. And because of it, I have 16 grandkids and one great grand today. Don't seem like I'm that old. I'm old. Everybody called me young. But see, when I met her, I didn't have white hair. Right? I've been to the mountain. I talked to the Lord. She did not touch my life that I got into the Bible Institute, which was under Dr. Ross. I went through that, and I went through college as well. And I learned how to walk and talk with Jesus.
Amen.
My sister, and Jackie truly is my sister, I love her, and I love also Dorothy. And I watched them as she raised them up, and Brother John. Okay. And I'm so glad to be here because of her faith. It has reached out and touched lives everywhere, more than what she could ever imagine. And I just want to say that I helped her do that yard. I even helped her. She said, Brother Andrew, I need my house painted. I said, I'll paint it. Remember I painted that house? I painted that house all by myself, outside. But that's the person she was. She taught me. She corrected me. She scolded me. She pushed me. And she encouraged me to be who I am today.
Amen.
And I thank God for it.
Good morning. I am a neighbor.
Okay, thank you.
I am one of the lawnside neighbors. I am one of the individuals who also has the assistance of Mr. Burton, our neighbor, to take care of my lawn on This is Selma, was a next door neighbor of mine. But not only was she a neighbor of mine, my whole family. My parents moved there.
You know, sometimes when you look at people's lives, sometimes you don't see the fullness of their life until they go, and until you begin to reflect. And one of the things, your mom, I used to be afraid of her. She had a way of staring at you, and her eyes would tell you what she was saying, and to say, I'm not for it, I'm not going to put up with this. And she didn't have to say any words, just her eyes would tell you those things. So I had to walk softly with her. But one thing I knew about your mom for certain was that she was a great mother.
Yes.
And she loved people genuinely. And she was like, I don't want to sound like this is not an insult to insult, but she was almost like a watchdog. She would watch and she would guard and look over, and if something wasn't right, she was going to say it and let you know. And actually, you know, one of the things I thought after she had passed, when I was reflecting over her life, she was like a shepherd.
Yes.
Now, every shepherd doesn't always have their names on a board outside of the church. There are some people that are shepherds that God has given that gift to. Does it sound like I'm reading this correct?
Yes.
That had a gift to watch over people and to be concerned about people because she had that passion. I'm not going to let the devil have you. She had that passion. I'm not going to allow discouragement or any vices of the enemy. I am going to come, just like when David killed the bear and killed the lion. She had that kind of spirit. I'm going to take on anything to try to hurt God's people, and I'm going to let you know the truth, because you should know the truth, and the truth should set you free. Amen?
Amen.
David, you ready? I guess the microphone's not. All right, the bonus son is coming in.
really hard to sum up what Nana meant to me in this brief time that I've been given. So, for the sake of time, I figured I'd focus on the single most important thing Nana ever did for me in my life, which was introducing me to Christ.
Amen.
Nana was a school teacher for 30 years, and after retirement, she took all of that teaching expertise and poured it into us, her grandchildren. I remember as little kids, we'd go over her house, and she'd have all these pre-planned Bible arts and crafts next to her. We'd sit around a table that she would set up for us downstairs, and we'd read through Bible passages. Then she'd ask us follow-up questions in sort of like a group format to make sure that we were not only comprehending the passages, but that we were beginning to actively think about how the verses of the Bible could be applicable to us in our current lives. From an early age, she challenged us to think of the Bible as God's living, breathing word. Afterwards, she'd always make us a homemade lunch, and after that, we typically retreat downstairs for an afternoon movie. Our favorite movie series at Nana's house was like the old school BBC-produced Chronicles of Narnia television series that was released on VHS in the 90s and predates all of like the newer CGI-enhanced Disney remake movies. Subsequently, she further challenged us to analyze the symbolism embedded within the characters, the narratives, the plots, and the subplots. And no matter how long our conversation carried on for, she'd always seem to end by focusing on the character of Aslan, the wise, compassionate king of the beasts who lays down his life in place of another, because, of course, his character symbolized Jesus. You see, Nana retired after 30 years in the public school district, but she never really stopped teaching. But the most important thing about Nana was that she did not simply teach you about Christ, but she then additionally modeled how to live your life like Christ every single day of her life. Right before she passed, I was sitting next to her and I started reminiscing on some of our memories together. And at one point I leaned over to her and I said, remember when we'd come over your house when we were young and you'd have us sit and watch those old school Chronicles and Narnia videos? And at the time, she was pretty weak, but she still managed to muster up one last smirk for me. I found Christ, I learned about Christ, and I fell madly in love with Christ because of her. She was a teacher, a sister, a mother, an aunt, a grandmother, and a friend to so many. But the role that she placed above all else, the one that came first and foremost, that she was a precious daughter of Jesus Christ our Lord, who was not afraid to proclaim his name and his glory. As much as I long for her to be right here with me, how comforting it is to know that she's now resting in the arms of her beloved Father. Nana was a very meticulous woman. All the major holidays were spent at Nana's house, and even as she grew older, her dining room was always immaculately prepared for the holiday dinner. Each seat had its corresponding formal plate utensil set up. Each person had a job, mine of which for almost 20 years now has been ice duty. I literally walk around with the ice bucket and I fill the glasses up with ice. I don't know what at what point I got assigned that role, but somebody had to do it. And each person had a specific seat at the table. And for many, many years now, my spot has been right next to Nana. I'm going to miss having her right there, right next to me. But how comforting it is to know that she's now seated at a much, much greater table. One that belongs to our King of Kings and Lord of Lords. A seat that has long been prepared just for her.
Amen.
She thought her table setup was doing something. When she got up there, she was probably mind blown. She dedicated her whole life to faithfully following him and passionately spreading the good news. And now, she's with him. Shortly after Nana passed, my mother, of tears, shouted to the top of her lungs, Mom, you made it.
so above all else today. Let us dwell on that victory.
Amen.
Because I believe, I truly believe, that is what she would want.
Amen.
By saying that Nana and I had a very special relationship. Often we would talk to each other for hours about current events and politics, to which Nana would respond to me by saying, "Jojo, you have a thick skull," which meant that I needed to come around to her wisdom. So no matter how wide and dispersed her political ideology was, there was always something that stuck. It was her love. This aspect being the most important, it was a lesson that over a year, Nana was trying to drill into my head. More specifically, it was an agape love. Nana didn't ever need to tell me that she loved me, she just did it. Probably can't pinpoint too many instances where she actually told me she loved me, but it was there every day. It was what she did, how she responded, showed us she loved us. For years, Nana was the first person I'd see every morning. You'd hear a light tap on the door. She'd poke her head through, say, "Okay, 5 more minutes, Jojo, then you gotta get up and go to school." She knew left to my own devices, 5 more minutes would turn into 5 hours. I missed the whole first half day of school. But she knew that education and my reputation was important to me, so she protected it. More importantly than Nana showing me how much she loved me was teaching me how to love. Throughout the years, Nana would wake me up in the morning, bring me over to her house. She'd have me cut the grass. She'd have me paint the outside, paint the inside, trim the bushes, plant, de-weed, water the garden, come inside, help cook, wear clothes. That's just a start. When I was young, she would give me a little bit of allowance for the hard work. But over the years, I stopped accepting the monetary reward because I didn't need it. But it became the reward of spending time with Nana, being able to help her with a simple task and spend some moments with her and talk about her favorite political ideas, which usually revolved around Michelle Obama, later her favorite character, Donald Trump. That was the lesson that Nana was teaching me all along, was how to love, how to give and show love, the most important lesson. It's a lesson that you can't just say, but it lives through the manifests. It was a hard lesson to learn, but it finally made its way through my thick skull. I can reflect on how much she really loved us, and now I just want to finally say thank you. So thank you.
Thank you.
I've ever asked for. I want to make sure that I continue to practice everything that she taught all of us, which is to love God, love each other, love people, our family, our friends, and to work hard, and to be curious and creative, and to search for enlightenment and be educated. And a lot of people don't have that in this world. I'm very grateful to have had my Nana in my life. My Nana is basically the reason why I am who I am. With art, I remember arts and crafts all the time. Build those dollhouses, not even really, like, sometimes she just, we just come over and she already have another one built, like, she's just super Nana, like, I mean, she's like, another one. Sweet. Best Nana ever, like, and just everything with her was just so peaceful, even when she was going through her little worry ward moments, which was all valid because, like another person today said, she made it her mission to make sure everybody was doing okay. And that is the most selfless thing I've ever seen. So I'm just really grateful.
That's
why I'm
Creator and the sustainer of life.
Yes.
we have come today not only as our God, but you are also our Father.
Amen.
For you have adopted us into your family. So we have come to say thank you for the life of our dear sister, mother, grandmother, friend. We have come to celebrate her life. Thank you for the many lives that she has touched. Thank you for the wonderful testimonies of her grandchildren, how she helped to mold them into what they are today.
Yes.
Thank you most of all that she gave her life to Jesus. So now her faith has become sight.
Yes.
She is now with her Lord. So we pray for this precious family, especially her two daughters and grandchildren, that you'd wrap your arms around them now. As they must begin this journey. Lord, we know that you promise that you'll never leave us or forsake us. So Lord, in the days and the weeks and the months and the years ahead, they continue to look to Jesus Christ, the author and the finisher of our faith. In whose name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to be brief no matter how long it takes.
Well,
I just want to respect the time. I know how far Holy Dream is. Respect the time. For I met Sister Atkins after I took over from Dr. Ross at the Bible Institute. Mm-hmm. I think apart from what she has instilled in her family, the legacy is to help people to learn.
Amen.
I think that's one of the greatest legacies, is to teach people and to help them to learn, because when you have an education, it's so much different. You know, because somebody said you cannot teach someone, you cannot teach stupid, but you can teach ignorance. And it means that we're, many of us, all of us are ignorant about something. So you can teach ignorance, but not stupid. And she taught many people how to read, and how to move, upward mobility, which in our community, that's what we need. It always amazed me that you can go to school for 12 years and still cannot fill out an application. So as Malcolm X said, poor neighborhood, poor children, poor teachers, poor neighborhood, and the cycle goes on. We thank God for Sister Atkins. I had not seen her, and she and Dorothy came to my graduation back in 1990. That was the last time I saw her. But I admired her so much because of the integrity that she had shown even over the Bible Institute. I did not know her. As you know, Deliverance was a very large church on Broad Street. Kind of get to know people in your own little niche. Got to know her very well. And I was the director of the Bible Institute in Belfield Avenue. And she was just a no-nonsense person who wanted to live for the Lord, because she's not going to heaven because she went to church. She's in heaven because she knew Jesus Christ
as
her Savior. So my little ritual, to make sure, I think this in 10 more minutes. How many people know that one day you are going to die?
Amen.
How many people, even though you did not raise your hand, you know you're going to die? And how many people, no matter what I say, you're not going to raise your hand? One day,
gonna go after death. Amen. Because death really means separation. That's what death means. Death means that now she's separated from her body, but she's still alive.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, even though he was dead, yet shall he live.
Amen.
He said, whosoever lives and believes in me shall never die.
Amen.
So how come she is in the casket? Said, whosoever lives and believes in me shall never die. What Jesus meant that whosoever lives and believes in me cannot be separated from me. Because that's what death means.
Mm-hmm.
So she is now with Jesus.
Amen.
But there is pain in death. Mm-hmm. The loss of a loved one brings pain. Here you guys are talking, I'm thinking when I pass, what my grandkids are going to be saying. Because we are examples, no matter what we think.
Amen.
Every day you're an example. It's whether you're a good example or a bad example. Every day you're leaving a legacy, depending on what legacy you're leaving. So for 5 more minutes, Paul was Saul before he became Paul. And in his second missionary journey, as you remember, Paul was in Troas, and he got a vision for a man beckoning him to come to Macedonia and help. So Paul went over into Macedonia, and it was not a man, but it was a woman. Her name was Lydia. She was, the scripture said, the seller of pearl. And as you remember, the church started in her home. And then Paul and Silas was placed in jail, and they were beaten mercilessly. And the scripture said at midnight they began to sing praises to God.
Amen.
The Lord miraculously unchained them, not only them, but all the other prisoners. And from there, Paul was let go and stopped in a couple more cities and then went to Thessalonica, where he planted another church. He was not there but for maybe 3 months before he was chased away to Berea. And from Berea he went to Athens, and from Athens he went to Corinth. And there Paul sent Timothy back to this young church in Thessalonica to find out how they were doing. So one of the questions that they had for Paul, what now will happen to our loved ones now that they have died? Probably they were killed because they had turned to Christianity. What would happen to our loved ones? Jesus hasn't come back and they're dead. So Paul wrote to them, among other things, he said, but I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also who sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words.
Amen.
So what Paul was saying, look, he doesn't want believers to be ignorant concerning those that are asleep. Or if you believe that Jesus died, how many people here believe that Jesus died and rose again? Even so, Paul said, those who sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. So let me ask you a question. Can I bring something with you with me if I don't have it in my possession? Right. So we know that believers Paul said to be absent from this body is to be present with the Lord.
Amen.
So he doesn't want us to sorrow as those who do not have hope. Sure you miss your grandma, your mom. Sure you miss your loved one. You will sorrow, but not as those who do not have hope.
Amen.
You have hope to see her again if you trust Jesus Christ as your Savior. Because every one of us, the scripture said, must stand before God to give an account of the deeds that we have done in our body. So my prayer is that the life that she lived and the many lives that she has touched, if you want to see her again, then you have to serve her Jesus. Not the Jesus of your own imagination, but the one who died on the cross, the one who was buried, the one who rose again on the third day, and the one today who is seated at the right hand of the Father. Praise God.
Amen.
Let us pray. I want to pray a prayer for all of us, but I also want to ask by a show of hands if today, where you're sitting, you have not made peace with Jesus, I'd like to include you in this prayer. Would you just slip your hand and so please pray for me? If you today are here and you have not made peace with God, now is the day. Now is the day of salvation, not tomorrow. We're just coming in the car, we heard of a billionaire just died in a helicopter, only 6. Tomorrow will be 61 years old. Billionaire. All his money could not save him. It's all about Jesus, isn't it?
Amen.
Amen. Is there anyone? Let's pray together. Father, we thank you. Thank you for this day. Thank you for your love and kindness and tender mercies towards us. Thank you, Lord, for Mother Atkins. Thank you for her life. And thank you that we could come and celebrate. Lord, I pray that now you'll continue with touching the hearts and lives of these precious family. Help them, Lord. Pray especially for Dorothy that you be with her. Help her. You are a miracle worker. Hallelujah. Thank you for Jackie. Love for her family. Just thank you for this time. Pray now that you would be with them as they travel to the cemetery. Take care of them, bring them back safely. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, rest, rule, and abide with us now, henceforth and forever. All of God's people say, Amen.
Amen.
give him a... As Jesus was preparing to go to the cross, to do the unimaginable work of covering the sins of every soul that would know humanity, he says, I am preparing to leave you, but I will send another. The Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost.
Discipline and everything, it didn't matter.
So. We was happy to not be walking.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that thing was hilarious. It's about today's day. I feel my car now.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever. Thy faithfulness more.